Hello students, today the topic of my lecture is gender and development issues. The term development has been viewed as a process of increase in intensity of modernization, urbanization, globalization and industrialization. Both women and men as human beings are affected by this process. Women are rather affected adversely as compared to men. Hence, the process of development is considered to be gendered by feminists. Though women constitute nearly half of the total human population, but the share in the process of development is very low. This low status has raised the issue of real purpose of development. Inequalities exist in male and female rights, responsibilities, access and control over resources. Men and women have different priorities and preferences with respect to development. Gender is a complex variable that is situated in social, cultural, economic, and political contexts. It is now felt that gender perspective should be an integral part of any development process, since women have always been a part of survival of any community. Feminists have always asserted that the development process affects women and men differently, and that women have not benefited sufficiently from development. To enhance the effectiveness of development process, gender considerations must be addressed, and women as stakeholders must be involved in all decision-making processes. Meaning and relation between gender and development. The term gender is nowadays being frequently used at national and international level. The United Nations Development Programme also lay emphasis on gender perspective. Now, let us first understand the meaning of term gender. There are certain differences between women and men. These differences are evident from the way they dress, talk, roles they perform, and their behavior. Women and men have different reproductive organs, but both have other similar organs like heart, brain, liver, pancreas, etc. The biological or physiological difference is called sex, and we use the term male sex and female sex, but this is not gender. Gender is the term used to understand the socially constructed differences between men and women. These differences are created by the society between a boy and a girl as they grow. They are brought up in a different way. Parents, relatives, neighbors, even institutions like school, courts, family, etc. have a fixed opinion regarding the role of men and women. So, gender refers to socially constructed and culturally variable roles that women and men play in their daily lives. The distinction between women and men as a result of their biological and physical differences is called sex, but the gender roles are set by tradition and other economic, political and cultural forces. From the feminist perspective, sex is based in nature, but gender is fluid and based in culture. World Health Organization states that gender refers to the economic, social and cultural attributes and opportunities associated with being male or female at a particular point in time. Development is a process that addresses the issue of human well-being and empowerment. The major question here is that who gets what from the development process? The development programs, despite high expectations and good intentions, not only failed to improve local conditions, but ignored women entirely. The feminist critic of development theory questions the women's role and their participation in development process. The women have been traditionally exploited, subordinated, and were considered to be the passive recipients of culture. The society, being patriarchal in nature, neglected the rights of women. Their status has been always secondary as compared to men. Social status refers to a position or a rank of a person or group within the society and can be determined in two ways. One can earn their social status by their own achievements, which is known as achieved status. The Global Gender Gap Index is an index designed to measure gender equality. The highest possible score is 1, which means equality, and the lowest possible score is 0, which means higher inequality. The Global Gender Gap Report was first published in 2006 by World Economic Forum. The 2014 report covers 142 major and emerging economies. The report examines 4 critical areas of inequality between men and women. Firstly, economic participation and opportunities, that is, outcomes on salaries, participation levels, and access to high-skilled employment. Secondly, educational attainment, that is, outcomes on access to basic and higher level education. Thirdly, political empowerment, that is, outcomes on representation in decision-making structures. And fourthly, health and survival outcomes on life expectancy and sex ratio. According to Hindustan Times News of October 2014, India has fared badly in removing gender-based disparities. It ranked 114th out of 142 countries in World Economic Forum's 2014 Gender Gap Index. India has scored below average on parameters like economic participation, educational attainment, and health and survival. It has slipped 13 spots from its last year's ranking of 101 on the Gender Gap Index. India is part of 20 worst performing countries on labor force participation, estimated earned income, literacy rate, and sex ratio at birth indicators. It is clear that development is a gendered process that affects women and men differently. And moreover, women throughout the world are adversely affected by this process. Feminist theories have been developed to address the problem of women's low status in society. The attempt to explain women's subordination has led to the development of many different feminist theories. Now, let's see the approaches to gender and development. The perspectives relating to gender and development were initiated during the International Women's Year Conference in 1975, where the slogan Equality, Development and Peace was proposed. The exchange of ideas took place during United Nations Decade of Women, that is, from 1976 to 1985. These debates and discussions at national and international level brought the issue of subjugation of women into limelight. What exactly constituted key women's issue was constantly being debated, and it was eventually realized that women's issue should not be treated separately. It was this continuous realization that women's integral role in development process that brought in the approaches of women in development, women and development, gender and development, and women, environment and development. Now, let us study these approaches. Women in development and its criticism. This approach, women in development, can be traced back to 1970s when Esther Bozerup published her book titled Women's Role in Economic Development. In that book, she analyzed the division of labor in agriculture-based societies. She demonstrated that women and men are differently placed socially in agriculture work and played different roles. She also pointed out that development policies did not treat women's work as separate from men's work because these differences were invisible. A lot of research was carried out in this direction after the publication of this book. Other problems such as women's disadvantaged position in education, health, employment, etc. were also identified. The researchers came to the conclusion that women were just being left out of the development process. The term women in development, WID, was coined in early 1970s by the Society for International Development. It is a network of female development that is a women's committee in Washington, D.C. It was later on adopted by United States Agency for International Development, that is USAID. The main assumptions of this approach are listed in box 2. The exponents of this approach are of the view that the economic strategies had a negative impact on women. Secondly, women must be brought into development process through access to employment and marketplace. Thirdly, it is important to integrate women into the process of development by designing and implementing projects for women which are income generating. Fourthly, we can say women can also be integrated into development process through legal and other reforms. Fifthly, it largely focuses upon development rather than economics of development. The question here is being asked that who gets what? This approach also subscribes to assumptions of modernization theory that traditional societies are authoritarian and male dominated, and the underdeveloped societies will have to pass through the same stages as the developed societies has gone through in the past. The prime focus of this approach is to integrate women into global economies. It emphasized for the treatment of women's issues in development projects and by improving their status and assisting in total development. Now, let's see the criticism of this approach, that is women in development. One of the major criticisms of this approach is that it treats women as beneficiaries. It targets women in order to make them a part of mainstream process of development, while ignoring the fact that women are already intrinsic part of development process. It is the women's work that is not counted as productive work. It is based on the traditional assumption that all developing societies have to pass through same process as the developed societies have passed. It overlooked the aspects of culture and class differences among women as some of the most important bases of women's marginalization. It added to women's workload because it did not have inbuilt mechanism to provide relief and save time. It was conformist approach, that is one that did not bring about fundamental change. It led to further marginalization of women because it compartmentalized them. Now, the second approach, women and development, that is WAD. This approach was developed in latter half of the 1970s as a critic of modernization and WID approach. It is closely linked with Marxist and dependency theory. Dependency theory focuses on imperialism as the key factor responsible for underdevelopment. It argues that economic development in the Western countries was made possible by the systematic exploitation of other countries. Marxist approach focused on development of capitalist relations of production rather than on imperialism. These are of the view that imperialism is merely the vehicle that carries capitalism over the globe. The exploitation of women's labor is seen as a part of class exploitation and is linked to capitalism and structures of production. Thus, within this framework, the changing role of women in economic production are determined by a number of factors, that is, the sexual division of labor, the local class structure, the manner in which specific regions and sectors of production are articulated within national and global economies. The major assumptions of this is mentioned in table 3. Like Marxists, these believe that there is exploitation of female labor globally by multinational companies. Such companies set up export processing zones in poor countries in which low paid female labor is exploited. It rejects the earlier WID approach that women needs to be integrated into development. This approach says that women have always been integral part of the productive processes. Task is to address the ways in which their labor has been unrecognized, exploited, and marginalized. This approach aimed to solve the problems of women by removing the unjust structures and inequitable relationships. Once these disappear and international equality is achieved, liberation of women will be achieved. This approach asserts that if given a chance, women would do better than their male counterparts. Women could achieve the desired equitable development acting on their own. Because of this, the theory has earned itself the label of WAD, that is, women and development. This perspective is of the view that women have always been integral part of the development process. Their work has always remained central to the maintenance of the societies. The task is therefore to address the ways in which their work would be recognized and to put an end to the exploitation and subjugation of women. Now, let us see the criticism of this approach. Some of the criticism leveled against this approach are that it does not address the class differences which exist even amongst women themselves. This approach, like the previous WID approach, groups women into a category. No clear distinction is made between the unique problems of the women and the problems they have common with men. It does not address the question of patriarchy, that is, the greatest source of gender inequality. Nor does it look at issues of subordination and related oppression. Now, let us see the next approach, which is gender and development and its criticism. The GAD or gender and development framework emphasizes on gender relations in both public and private sphere. Unlike the previous approaches, WID and WAD, it focuses not just on women, but on social relations between men and women in workplace and at home. It uses gender relations rather than women as a category of analysis, thus focusing on structures of patriarchy rather than on men and women. It tries to analyze the role and contribution of all members of community and not just only women, and also focuses on the differences and disparities of men and women. The main assumptions of this approach are cited in Table 4. In order to achieve equitable development, there is need to transform unequal class and gender relations by empowering women and other disadvantaged people who may include men. This approach also proposes the development of both public and domestic sector, because public sector can only function because it is supported by the invisible domestic sector in which women dominate. This approach also recognizes that gender roles are constructed socially and therefore can be changed. It highlights reproductive roles alongside productive roles and recognizes they make an equal contribution. It supports setting up system that reduce women's workload and release them from domestic hardships. This perspective proposes a fundamental re-examination of social structures and institutions that will lead to change in power dynamics in the relation between men and women. This approach also demands a degree of structural change and power shift. It favors granting access and control of resources to women. Now, let's see the criticism of this gender and development approach. This approach has been criticized for overemphasizing on social differences between men and women while neglecting the bonds between them and also the potential for change in roles. Another criticism is that this approach does not go deep enough into social relations and is not able to explain how these relations can undermine programs that are directed towards women. It has been observed that this perspective is theoretically distinct from WID, but in practice, both are more or less the same. Many development agencies are now committed to a gender-based approach in practice, but the primary institutional perspective remains as WID. Development agencies still take gender transformation to mean economic betterment of women and not empowerment of women. Now, let's see the fourth approach, women, environment and development, and its criticism. The women, environment and development debate, WED, analyzes critically the relation between development policies on one hand and environmental degradation on the other. The feminists argue that mainstream development strategies are destroying the environment and the living conditions for more and more people. These feminists connect the degradation of environment with the subjugation and exploitation of women. The women, environment and development concept revolves around the principles of equitable access to natural resources as well as providing equal economic benefits to both men and women as members of society. Development policies should ensure gender equality, provide equal economic opportunities, access to social amenities, involvement of women in decision making and control over natural resources. The main points of this approach are summed up in Table 5. This perspective arises from ecofeminism, which draws parallels between male control over nature and over women. The names of Vandana Shiva and Maria Mies, along with others, are associated with this approach. Vandana Shiva highlighted the role of women in Chipko movement. Ecofeminists argue that masculine oriented scientific and industrial systems have relentlessly exploited natural resources and have brought the planet to the verge of ecological extinction. The very notion of development means the control and conquest of nature, bringing the earth to the brink of ecological disaster. Vandana Shiva stresses the ethical point of women as caretakers and sees a deeper spiritual connection of women with nature than men due to gendered culture development. Maria Mies sees the nearness of women to nature as a result of historical developments in which women, because of their capacity of giving birth, are bound to be close to nature in a special way. The basic question in this perspective is, what causes the oppression of both women and environment? In opposition to the ecofeminist approach, Indian ecologist Beena Agarwal suggests an alternative framework which is named as environmental feminism. This is a more materialistic and pragmatic political approach. She talks about the management of gender relations in connection with environmental management strategies and stresses the role of customs, laws, and social structures in determining women's relationship to their environment. She suggested that environmental feminism aims to bring about changes in following ways. Firstly, composition of what is produced. Secondly, technologies needed to produce it. Thirdly, processes by which decisions on first two points are arrived at. Fourthly, the knowledge systems on which such choices are made. The class and gender distribution of products and tasks. Connections between environment and gender can be made by looking at the gender division of labor and environmental roles rather than an inherent connection with nature. In this perspective, the different forms of relationship to the environment are seen as caused by different forms of interaction between human beings and their material interests. The theoretical debate about the relationship of women and environment is still going on within feminist theories. Today, the political debate about women, environment, and development in a global perspective is focused more often around the key concept of sustainable development and globalization. Feminist political ecology has emerged from ecofeminism and environmental feminism and seeks to discover the role and place of women in environmental development on political scale. Now let's see the criticism of gender, environment, and development approach. Many people have criticized the ecofeminist that they have failed to address the issue of diversity, different interests, and needs of women. Without getting real power, women are allocated the function of nurses for the ill environment. Some people have even criticized this approach as being essentialist, since it is also being equated with cultural feminism. This approach is also challenged by gender, environment, and development approach, that is GED. It pays more attention to gender relations in households, property rights, labor relations, and kinship systems. These assert that the assumption of women's inborn tendency to protect the environment is totally misleading. Now, coming to the conclusions, women's issue in development discourses were taken more seriously during the United Nations Women's International Decade of Women, that is from 1976 to 1985. The debates and discussions brought the issue of subjugation of women into limelight. Development strategies were criticized for the failure to recognize the contribution of women in economy and society. The importance of women's roles in society was considered in the formulation of development policies and programs. It has led to the inclusion of gender in the development process, and it led to the emergence of approaches such as Women in Development, WID, Women and Development, WAD, Gender and Development, GAD, and Women Environment and Development, WED. These approaches, that is Women in Development approach, views the exclusion of women from the development process as the problem, whereas Women and Development sees the inequitable international structures as a problem. Gender and Development perspective opines that the unequal power relations between women and men is the problem, whereas the Women Environment and Development, that is WED approach, points out at the gender division of labor and environmental roles as a problem. Gender equality, protection of environment and sustainable development are intrinsically linked. These linkages cut across the social, economic, political dimensions of sustainable development. It is important to assess the challenges of development and its effects on women and environment. The initiatives taken by policy planners to engage women as full stakeholders have proven to enhance sustainable livelihoods of economies. With this, we come to the end of today's lecture. Next time, we shall discuss another topic. Till then, goodbye and thank you.